So after tracking, compositing and rendering, we should have a look if everything went fine. So first of all, I want to have a look at my render output. So I've rendered as an image sequence into this folder and I want to have a look at the result. And there are several ways to do that. Of course, we could just use the video sequence editor. We could also use the movie clip editor, but also you can go to render and then click on play rendered animation. Now, chances are that this won't work because it has to use an external player, as the tooltip says. So before you can use that, you should go into the user preferences and assign an animation player. Now, there are several presets and I have to say that these for some reason do not really work for me, so changing that doesn't change anything. But well, if you are on OS X, then you can just use the QuickTime Player app. Or another great player is the DJV player. Now, if you don't know that already, then I can really only recommend it. It's really a great player for any image sequences and also for movie files. So you can just drag in your DPX sequences, your JPEG sequences, OpenXR, PNG, whatever. It will just play back immediately. So I can really only recommend it. So please go ahead and download that. It's also open source. And once you've done that, well, just install it like you would do any other application. So if you have installed that, then you can just choose the path. And if you are on OS X, then you have to go inside of the .app directory and then go to Contents, macOS, and then you can just choose that. If you are on Windows, then I assume you only have to select the executable. And on Linux, there's also a way to select that. I don't know because I don't really know that much about Linux. But anyway, you just have to select the executable file and then click on accept. And now when I go to render and then select play rendered animation or use the shortcut control F11, and that will then launch the DJV player and you can playback the final animation. Now, one thing about this player, it can also load your footage into the RAM, but only if you enable file memory cache. So you have to do that in order to have real-time playback. Now, the next thing, let's set it to fit. And so far, that looks really good, especially here in this area that is stable and everything seems to be fine. But if you have a close look back there, that doesn't really look correct. So there is some sliding. And there is some sliding even though we have used the undistortion. So in theory, everything should be fine, but the fact is it just isn't right. And the reason for that is that we didn't track enough markers here in this area. Because here we would have a lot of information about the foreground. And also the second reason is that here on the outside of the frame, you have the most lens distortion. And since we are calculating actually the lens distortion, we should be able to get as much information about the lens and the distortion as we could. So maybe we should track more markers here in this area and on the outside of the frame so that we get really the exact information about the lens distortion. And it is also a very typical problem that you only really see the issues with your track, if there are any, if you have a final render. Because here you have something, here you have something, here you have something, and by just looking at these markers, you won't see if there is any sliding in that region. So always try to cover as much of the footage as you can. So let me go to frame one, then reload, cache everything into the RAM just to avoid any problems with QuickTime or FFmpeg. And then place some more markers here in this area. For example, that would be a good candidate to track. So Control T to track that, and it tracks just fine. And now that we are on the last frame, let's also pick something here, maybe that corner, then Control Shift T, or I don't know the official shortcut, just track backwards, like so. All right. Then maybe something here, Control T. And then also something up there, maybe that corner, track backwards. And also that. All right, so now we have covered more of the space here in the foreground and in that area. Also maybe one more marker here and then another one there. All right, Shift S. And you can see that the average solve error actually went up, but that is not necessarily a problem. I mean, the more markers you have, the more little jittering there can be. So it is not necessarily a problem if you have a slightly bigger average solve error, but if the benefit of that is that you have more information about the lens distortion here in that area, then it's no problem if you have a little bit bigger solve error here. Right. Now, let's have a look at the 3D scene. Still seems to fit pretty good. Let's look from the front. And, well, there seems to be a little problem because the camera went up. So the markers that have before been on the ground are not exactly on the ground anymore. And we can just manually move the camera down just so that these points are now on the ground again. So rotate slightly like so. And now that should be again correct. Okay, now let me try to render that again. I mean, we don't need to change anything in the composite, that is still fine. So we just have to render again and then see how that looks like. And indeed, the final rendered animation of that looks, in fact, a bit better than before. So the sliding that we saw here in this area is indeed much better than before. I mean, of course, the problem with these tires here looks not correct, so that, of course, doesn't really fit. But if you look at this point here, that now is really pretty stable. And if you would have better textures and better models here, then it would, in fact, look okay.